happening at the VMMC. If you just joined us, the Arroyo camp, the camp of former President Gloria Macapagal Arroyo, has posted a 1 million peso bail in connection with the electoral sabotage case against Gloria Macapagal Arroyo. Again, we're still monitoring that. We now go back to the JBC.
He's actually the administrator of the Supreme Court. And I understand that 30% of his time is devoted to writing decisions, but the bulk of his time, about 70%, is devoted to administering the court system. And therefore, the Chief Justice must exhibit managerial skills, because he will have to interact with the members of the lower courts, and also he will have to interact with the two other branches of government. I understand that there is a judicial, executive, legislative, advisory and consultative council, wherein the three heads of government sit down to thresh out problems of besetting the country. And that is one of the functions of the Chief Justice. And I think he will have to make adjustment so that he will be able to fulfill those two-pronged functions.
Thank you, Attorney Morales. Now let's tackle the adjudicatory function. Now, having worked in the private sector practically all of your legal career, throughout your legal career, how will you overcome the fact that you perhaps may have to undergo some kind of orientation as how decisions are prepared in the Supreme Court?
Well, the duties that I do in the private sector as the managing partner of CSIP Salazar Hernandez and Gatmaitan are almost similar to what a Chief Justice does. For the past 37 years, I have been writing opinions to clients, which is actually similar to decisions being written by the justices of the Supreme Court. Facts are presented to me by clients, and I render an opinion based on the facts and the applicable law. Also, as I mentioned already, the Chief Justice is the administrator of the entire judiciary, and I, as the managing partner, administers the different departments of my firm, and I interact with other colleagues. We are a member of 7 international networks, and I interact with them. So the functions of the Chief Justice are not really strange to me.
Which brings me to the next aspect of the question, which is on administration. And you mentioned that from what you know, 70% of the work that is to be done by the Chief Justice involves administration, particularly the administration of justice. What in your recent past will show that you have the skills required to manage and to administer justice?
In terms of management, I have been the president of the Inter-Pacific Bar Association, which is an association of more than 2,000 lawyers coming from more than 70 jurisdictions. And I was able to competently interact with the members. I presided over meetings of the General Assembly. And I think those are substantially similar to what the Chief Justice will be doing.
So what was something that you feel that was a major accomplishment in so far as, you know, getting things done in the organization, which you feel is necessary for someone who has to manage courts nationwide?
Well, we held an international conference in Manila, and that was organized by myself as the chair of the host committee. And the theme of the conference was about the changing face of legal practice and how the lawyers could help in the promotion of social justice and generally cope with the changing face of the legal profession.
As a candidate for the position of Chief Justice, what is your vision for the courts? What do you want to accomplish in the judicial system within the next 5 years if appointed Chief Justice?
I understand that there is an action program for judicial reform in place, and that has been declared by the World Bank as the model for the region. During my watch as Chief Justice, I would like the entire action reform to be implemented, particularly in the matter of decongesting the dockets of the court, and providing upward salary adjustments to judges so that the independence of the judiciary will be further enhanced.
I also noticed that you are the managing partner of CCIP Salazar Hernandez and Gapaitan Law Office, law firm. And how long have you had this? Have you held this position?
About over 2 years now.
And as managing partner, do you still actually litigate cases? Do you go to court?
I don't go to trial, but as managing partner, I am involved in litigation in the sense that I help conceptualize and strategize cases. My role as a litigator is akin to the role of a solicitor in the United Kingdom. The solicitor helps in strategizing the cases, helps in writing pleadings, but it is the barrister that appears before the court. And both the solicitors and the barristers are intimately involved in the litigation. My function is akin to that of a solicitor.
What do you is the most serious problem that is plaguing the judicial system today?
It is the inability of the courts to render judgment to dispose of cases speedily.
And what do you think is the cause of that delay?
It is because the courts are undermanned. If you have a vineyard in which there are a lot of grapes to be harvested and there are only a few workers, the logical step is to hire more workers. But in the judiciary, about 25% of vacancies has not been filled up. So the judiciary is undermanned. And that's why I was proposing the upward adjustment of the salary scales of the judges so that we can attract more applicants from a wider range of applicants. Yeah.
On a practical sense, when was the last time that you visited a court?
It was about a few years ago.
A few years ago. And which court is this?
Regional trial court.
Is it here in Metro Manila?
Yes, it is in Metro.
Okay, so you have not had the occasion to visit a court in the provinces?
No, but yeah, no.
How about, have you had any conversation with perhaps a judge or a court personnel to really find out, you know, from their perspective, what seems to be the problem causing the delay?
Yes. And I've also been in discussion with my partners who are in the litigation department of my firm.
Okay. So what was your basis for coming up with these proposals, considering that it has been some time since you've actually been in the courts?
It is precisely my discussions with my partners in the litigation department. We have a very big litigation department in CCIP Salazar Hernandez and Gamaitan.
I went through the list that you presented in your personal data sheet of the seminars that you've attended, also in the symposia that you have participated in. And except for two, which you participated in 1982, which is on the rulemaking of administrative agencies, and as a participant and a speaker for the opportunities and challenges of managing a law firm in just last April. The rest were all on banking, commerce, and taxation. How will you remedy the fact that perhaps with respect to other aspects of the administration of justice, when it comes to criminal cases and to civil cases, What have you done to augment, perhaps, you know, the lack of focus on these aspects of administration in your career?
Well, to be a trial lawyer is not necessarily a guarantee that you'll make a good justice. In fact, there are lawyers from our firm who became justices of the Supreme Court. And I could cite Justice Florentino Pipiluciano, who was a corporate lawyer in my mold, and he became a good justice of the Supreme Court. Justice Sereno is also was a former associate of our firm, and she was not a trial lawyer. The acting chief justice was a corporate lawyer before he became a justice of the Supreme Court.
Well, I guess perhaps the challenge is becoming the next chief justice, because there is so much that is expected of him, and therefore, if he does not have the skills required for the work, then perhaps it may just, we may still face the same problems plaguing our courts today. Now,
I have already mentioned, ma'am, that what I do in CSIP Salazar is similar to what the Chief Justice does. And I've reached the point in my career that I am willing, ready, and able to do full-time public service.
Thank you. You are in your 60s.
I'm 61 years old.
Did it ever occur to you in the past to render public service?
Yes. In fact, every Saturday I teach at the College of Law of the UP.
Could you tell us what subjects you teach?
It's banking and finance. And then I taught for some time corporation law, legal ethics.
There is a constant clamor for our justice system to address the needs of the underprivileged. What reforms would you propose in order to meet this demand?
I am in favor of making the courts more accessible to litigants. I think that the filing fees are quite very high, and I am in favor of reducing the filing fees. But in order to recoup losses possible from the reduction of legal fees, I would work for the increase in the share of the judiciary in the national budget. I understand that it's only 1%, and I'm surprised why that is too low for a third branch of the government to be given only 1% of the national budget. Is, I think, is scandalous.
In the choice of perhaps your legal team.
We're breaking from the JBC interviews for a while to give you this. The Arroyo camp has posted a 1 million peso bail for former President Arroyo's poll sabotage case. Let's get more details from ABS-CBN's Gretchen Malalad. Gretchen, go ahead.
Yes, sir. A few minutes ago, the legal counsel of former lawyer Maxidal Arroyo, Raymond Monty Sanders, had paid a 1 million bail bond for the release of his client, charged with 2 counts of electoral sabotage. The 1 million pesos was in a brown envelope. The clerk of court, Mary Dixie Bayan, had received the bail bond. As of this time, the clerk of court is still counting the money, according to Attorney Santos. After the payment, the release papers will be processed, and within the day, GMA will be released. According to Attorney Felda Domingo, the spokesperson of RTC Branch 211, says that the court had granted bail, even though this is a non-bailable case, because they found evidence against Gloria Macapagal Arroyo weak. They based it on the statement of Nori Una, the witness of the prosecution, saying Una only overheard in a meeting that GMA ordered a 12-0 win at Maguindanao province. So because of this statement, the court found the evidence very weak, so they granted the bail. Ron?
Gretchen Malala, thank you very much for that update. You're seeing live shots of what's happening outside the VMMC. A group of protesters has gathered outside the main gate. We did see a tweet from Renato Reyes of Bayan asking for people to have an emergency picket at the veterans because of the ruling of Judge Jesus Mupas to grant bail to the Arroyo camp. Again, just a backgrounder, the Arroyo camp has posted a 1 million peso bail in connection with the electoral sabotage against the former president. With this development, the former president may already be allowed to leave the VMMC, but as DZMM's Henry Atuelan reported earlier, they may have to seek a go-ahead from the doctors of the VMMC before she is allowed to leave. We had the Kabalek chair, Sixto Brillantes, saying that they will file a motion for reconsideration on the ruling by today or tomorrow. It was Judge Jesus Mupas who allowed the former president to post a 1 million peso bail but denied bail for Arroyo's co-accused, former Maguindanao Governor Andal Ampatuan Sr. and former election supervisor Lentang Bedol. Also in the news, it was yesterday that the Sandigan Bayan's 1st Division issued a hold departure order, this time on the plunder case against the former president involving illegal use of PCSO funds. Gloria Arroyo still also has another case, two counts of graft for the botched NBN-ZTE deal, also at the Sandigan Bayan. Gretchen Malalo reporting a while ago that Judge Jesus Mupas allowed the posting of bail for former President Gloria Macapagal Arroyo, even though this was supposed to be a non-bailable offense, because the evidence against the former president was weak. We're still monitoring developments there. We're going to contact all our correspondents who are stationed there at the VMMC, at the Sandigan Bayan, and at the Pasay RTC. We're going to be talking to them all throughout the day to find out what's happening. But meantime, we now go back to the JBC interviews.
Total mobile phones that are sold each.
I think that we should adopt the standard deduction so that you limit the discretion of the examiners when they examine or make assessment of taxpayers.
So you, you're suggesting that we revert, for example, to the system of gross income taxation?
Yes, something like that.
As my final question, po, should you be appointed as Chief Justice, can you give us an idea of your work ethic as such Chief Justice?
I do work very diligently for the past 37 years. It is precisely the excellence which is a cornerstone in our law firm that over the 37 years of legal practice has propelled me to what I am now in my law firm. It's diligence, promptitude, and reasoned legal opinions.
Thank you, Attorney Morales. Thank you, Justice Peralta. That will be all. Good luck, po.
Justice Lagman, please.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chair. Attorney Morales, good morning.
Good morning.
You stated earlier that if you will be the next Chief Justice, you will provide real justice to our people. Can you please explain what you mean by real justice?
Well, it is whenever there is a case pending, it is the duty of a judge to dispose of it speedily.
Yes.
As the saying goes, justice delayed is justice denied.
Yes.
That way, people would have, redress of grievances. And I think speedy disposition of cases is a must so that the people's confidence in the justice system will be restored.
So, and if you will be the next Chief Justice, how are you going to do that? To speed up the disposition of cases or to declog the dockets of the courts nationwide?
Well, first of all, I would see to it that the vacancies would be filled up.
Yes.
Secondly, I think that we have to strengthen the research staff. We should employ more researchers. And if possible, we employ interns.
Interns?
Yes. So that there will be additional bodies that will do research, speed up the work. Mm-hmm. And I think we should encourage shorter decisions. For instance, if the Supreme Court thinks that the decision which is under appeal from the Court of Appeals is sound, then the Supreme Court's decision should merely say that we adopt by reference the facts and the findings of law of the Court of Appeals, and then, you know, a one-page decision would be all right and in compliance substantially with the Constitution of the Philippines.
Okay. Attorney Morales, considering your experience, there's no doubt that you possess the management skills required in running the judiciary. However, to effectively discharge your function as the chief executive officer of the judiciary and lead the court, you must do it with moral ascendancy. And you can only have moral ascendancy if you have the respect, the trust, and confidence of all the associate justices working with you. Attorney Morales, can you tell us how you intend to get the respect, the trust, and confidence of the incumbent justices, most of whom are older than you, not only in age, but in terms of length of service in the judiciary?
I am a consensus builder.
Yes.
I would like to reach out with my colleagues at the Supreme Court and appeal to their sense of patriotism, seek their cooperation in the interest of country and people. And with respect to seniority, I think that seniority is not always observed in the Supreme Court.
Yes.
As borne out by the fact that two younger justices are candidates for the position. And also, the acting chief has come up with a declaration in an interview that he would respect the decision of the President of the Philippines whether the appointee would be an insider or outsider.
Okay. So, during the impeachment trial of the former Chief Justice, the moral fitness of a candidate for that position was raised. Now, can you tell us your perception of moral fitness as a criteria in selecting the next Chief Justice?
Moral fitness is number one in my list. Honesty is the best policy. You know? Without integrity, on the part of the Chief Justice, people would not repose trust and confidence in the court system.
Okay, let's go to another point. It is given that the two political branches of government, namely the executive and the legislative, have the primary responsibility of promoting the economic well-being of the country. In one of his lectures, a former Chief Justice stated that the judiciary has a similar duty to nurture prosperity and alleviate poverty in our country. Do you agree, Attorney Morales?
To some extent. Although on matters dealing with the economics,
yes,
I would probably exhibit judicial restraint.
Okay. So how are you going to do that? How are you going to do that?
If a case is brought before the Supreme Court and it concerns economic policies, then I would probably exhibit judicial restraint in that I would uphold and sustain the policies promulgated by the executive or the legislative branch.
Okay, I'm sure you're aware of that provision in the new constitution that it is not only the power but the duty of the court to strike down acts of any branch or instrumentality of government committed in grave abuse of discretion.
Yes, ma'am.
So, do you want to comment on that in relation to your previous answer?
Well, that actually expanded judicial review.
Yes.
And that eroded somewhat the political question doctrine. And that answers the criticism founded on the doctrine of counter-majoritarian. Because whenever the Supreme Court strikes down as unlawful or unconstitutional a legislative or executive act, the Supreme Court is said to be counter-majoritarian. Because those acts are acts of the political branches of government that have been elected by the majority of the people. But again, that loses sight of the fact that the Supreme Court is granted by the people under the Constitution to determine whether there has been a grave abuse of discretion amounting to lack or excessive jurisdiction by any instrumentality of government.
Yes. Okay. Now, if you will be fortunate to be nominated and appointed as the next Chief Justice of our country, will you kindly tell us your top three priorities upon assumption of office?
I'm going to fill up the vacancies because judiciary is undermanned. Second, I would work for the upward adjustment of salaries to prevent or to stem the brain drain in the judiciary, because we cannot attract the bright people because the salaries in the private sector.
This will be my last question in connection with your answer. We all know that a chief justice is both a jurist and the chief executive officer of the judiciary. As a jurist, a chief justice is expected not only to be actually independent, but must be perceived as independent at all times. However, as a CEO, he has to deal with officials from the other two branches of government and maintain a harmonious relationship with his people. Now, can you tell us, Attorney Morales, how you can balance these two seemingly conflicting functions? How can you preserve your independence and at the same time maintain a cordial relationship with the officials of the other two branches of government?
The two justices are not mutually inconsistent. Independence, a judge is independent if he's able to decide the case purely on the basis of the merits.
Yes.
And swayed by any partisan interest, not influenced by family, social, or other relationship. Mm-hmm. That is independence as defined in the Code of Judicial Conduct.
Mm-hmm. Then?
Interacting with the executive or legislative officials does not necessarily detract from the independence of the Chief Justice. In fact, that is supposed to be encouraged because the judiciary is not supposed to be staying in the ivory tower.
So, your idea is of a Chief Justice is not to stay in the ivory tower all the time, but he has to go out?
Yes, ma'am. Precisely, the judicial, executive, legislative, advisory, consultative council was created
GILA.
Precisely for that purpose,
yes. You know,
for the interaction between and among the heads of the different branches of government.
So you believe in the benefits derived from activating this GILA?
Absolutely.
Okay. On that note, Mr. Chair, I have no more questions for Attorney Morales. Thank you, Attorney Morales.
Justice Hermosissima.
Good morning, Attorney Morales.
Good morning.
any relation to the ombudsman?
No relation.
No relation at all. I was hoping you'd say yes. Well, the tremendous inherent power in the hands of the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court require that those appointed to the position should possess the highest degree of competence, integrity, and judicial prudence, because the administration of justice is a sacred task entrusted only to individuals with the highest degree of competence. A judicial position is a position of honor and is offered only to those who are best qualified. You have never been a judge before, nor were you a justice of the appellate courts. How do you?
We're pulling away from the JBC interviews again. Some commotion happening outside the Veterans Memorial Medical Center. It's a vehicle bearing a number 8 plate. We are still not sure who is inside that vehicle, but the reporters have converged at a vehicle who just left. Again, we're still monitoring what's happening at the Veterans Memorial Medical Center. We have Attorney Raul Lambino now on the line. Attorney Lambino, good morning.
Good morning, Ron, and good morning to our fellow viewers.
Okay, as we reported a while ago, the Arroyo camp has been allowed to post bail and has already posted the 1 million peso bail. What are your plans now? Where is the president right now, sir?
The president is still here at the Veterans Memorial Medical Center, and we are waiting for the release order to be issued by the regional trial for directing the Philippine National Police to unpack the former president. And we hope that there will be no obstacles, that this release order will be issued to the court and will be served accordingly to the Philippine National Police. And we are expecting that the government will respect the decision of the court in time, but they are not going to do anything that would against the justice that needs to be served. No? And the former president has been put in jail for 7 months already for incitement. Very clearly, the judge found out, and in the hearing, and based on the decision that the judge issued, that there was no evidence of guilt to prove the electoral sabotage as charged by the Department of Justice and the Commissioner of Election against the government.
Attorney Lambino, what time are you expecting the release order? You have to wait for the release order there. The president has to physically receive the release order, or the officials there have to physically receive the release order before the former president is allowed to leave the VMMC. Is that correct?
We have to wait for the order of the Philippine National Police also, because the release order will be issued by the court, and then this release order will be served on the Philippine National Police. And the Philippine National Police will come up on the paper, and then we are going to wait for the decision of the Philippine National Police regarding this. Now, we cannot just live here, even if they know that we have already posted the required bond, because these are administrative matters that must be observed, and we will wait for that, and hopefully everything can be done and finished within the day.
What time are you expecting the release order to arrive, sir? What hour?
We do not know yet, Ron, unfortunately, but we have our lawyers attending the regional trial court in Pasay, and we are following this up. It will be served within the day at the Philippine National Police Headquarters in Pasay.
Attorney Lambino, are you in the room with the former president right now?
No, I'm outside the hospital now because there is no telephone that is allowed to be brought
inside
detention facility. So I'm now outside the veterans memorial hospital.
But who is with Mrs. Arroyo right now, sir?
Well, she is there inside her detention room, and I am here outside the building.
Okay. We had a reported a while ago, DCMM's Henry Atuelan, saying that you also need to wait for the doctor's orders for their approval to have Mrs. Arroyo leave the VMMC. Is that correct, sir?
I really don't know what are the procedures here at the Veterans Memorial Medical Center. That would be the case, because she is in effect still also considered, we don't know if she is considered a patient of the VMMC here. So, I really am not aware of the internal procedures here at the VMMC.
Okay. If the Arroyo camp finally receives a release order from the Pasay RTC, what's going to be the plan? Is she going home directly, sir?
I believe so, Ron. And there's no other place for her to go except her home in Tabita. So I can only assume that that would be where she would be going if and when the order of release will be fulfilled and issued there.
Okay, Attorney Raul Lambino, thank you very much for talking to us. We will be calling you again later in the following newscast, sir, to hopefully get some more updates from you, sir.
Thank you,
sir. Okay, Attorney Raul Lambino there. Former President Arroyo is expected to leave detention soon. Let's get more details. We have on the line ABS-CBN correspondent Alex Santos, who joins us from the VMMC. Alex, go ahead.
Okay, Ron, we're here in front of the VMMC entrance gate, kung saan na marami ng mga ano dito ron, na may sumugod na dito, mga militanteng grupo, kinabibilangan ito ng bayan, Gabriela, kung saan na pinagsisigawan pa rin nila na hindi karapat-dapat daw makalaya itong si dating Pangulo at ngayon ang Pampanga Congresswoman Gloria Macapagal Arroyo matapos kang magpalabas ang branch RTC ng Pasay 112. At nilang grant sa petition for bail nitong ni Pangulong dating Pangulong Gloria Macapagal Arroyo kung kaya't nakapagahin na ito ng 1,000,000 piyansa sa Pasay RTC kanina. Sa ngayon, punong-puno na ito ng mga militanteng grupo itong entrance gate at maging na magagawad ng media at inaantabayanan na lamang ang ganap na paglapas ni dating PGMA patungo sa kanyang tahanan sa La Vista. Inaasahan natin at kanina nga, napansin natin lumabas dito ang kanyang anak na si Mikey, Congressman Mikey Arroyo, at hindi nagbigay sa atin ng kaunting palayan para makuha naman lang natin kung ano ang follow-in ng kanyang ina. Dahil dito sa pangyayaring itong makakalabas siya ang kanyang ina. Pero nakausap natin ang minority floor leader ng Kamara na si Congressman Danilo Suarez ng lalawigan ng Quezon. At binanggit niya na mukhang masaya. Masaya raw ang dating Pangulo at maging sila. Kari ng partido ay masaya sila at inaasahan nila makakalapas ang kanilang dating leader na si dating PGMA na Pangulo ng Pilipinas na Ross.
Alex, nakita nga natin kanina parang pakonti-konting dumadami yung mga nag-pro-protesta dyan. No? Matanong ko lang, Alex, kasi doon sa nakikita natin sa monitor, parang dalawang, tatlong pulis lang nandyan sa labas. Eh. Kamusta ba siguro din dyan?
Itong napapansin mo dito ron sa mismong malapit sa North Avenue, itong area ng northbound ng North Avenue, tama ka, dalawang pulis na nandito, pero mas maraming pulis yung sa looban mismo ng main gate ng BNP. Nandun lahat ang mga pulis kung saan hindi pinapayagan ang mga protesters na makalapit doon at maging ang media. Nandito lang ang media. Kung makikita mo sa camera, ito nga, tatlo nga. Ito yung kanilang binabantayan ay yung flow lamang ng dali ng trapiko dahil nga medyo sumisigit at nahirapan yung mga gustong pumasok sa hospital para magpagamot.
Alex, ang alam natin, meron pang mga ibang entrance saka exit dyan sa BMMC. Ngayon itong mga grupong to, Bayan Gabriela, meron din bang mga nagpro-protesta doon sa mga ibang pasukan at labasan dyan sa ospital?
Sa ating pagkakaalam, Ron, dahil nandito tayo sa main gate ng BMMC, I'm sure meron sila mga ibang kasamahan na nandun sa area at maging ang media ay nakaantatay rin doon sa bandang Mindanao Avenue. Dalawa kasi ang ingress at egress ng mismong ospital. Kaya lahat, all agusan, binapatay natin at maging itong mga militanteng grupo ay nakaantatay rin sila doon para makita ang paglabas at ipagtigil siguro marahil dito sa paglabas ni dating Pangulong Gloria Macapagal-Arroyo.
May nabanggit ba sila, Alex, kung anong plano nila kung sakaling lalabas na yung si Mrs. Arroyo? Harangin ba nila? Pipigilan ba nilang makalabas si Mrs. Arroyo? May sinabi ba?
Ang tanong ni Ron sa ANC, may plano ba kayo, Renato, na haharangin in case makikita niyo si Gloria na lumabas?
Hindi naman ho namin haharap dahil nagsitakil po yun, pakasagasaan lang nila yung tao. Pero ang gusto namin sana, makita na yung mga mukha ng mga tao na hindi titigil na hindi siya napapanagot.
Okay, yun. Yan ang pagkakasagasaan nito.
Alex, may isa pa akong katanungan. Merong mga ibang naka mga signs na nakataas, no? Parang pinagbibintangan din si President Noynoy Aquino na dahil sa wala niyang kagagawan ay kaya nakapag-post ng bail si Mrs. Arroyo. Bakit? Bakit pati si President Aquino ay napagbintangan at nasabit sa protesta nila?
The president is responsible for filing the cases, for gathering evidence, for making sure that the cases will stand in court. Not just one case, but several cases, because we all know that GMA is guilty of many more crimes, not just election sabotage. But unfortunately, the election sabotage case appears to be a weak case. That's why the judge favored the bail petition of GMA, even if the case is not an offense. And we are also waiting if there will be a warrant of arrest issued by the Sandigan Bayan on the case. If they don't issue a warrant of arrest, then GMA has no, there will be no legal basis to hold GMA any further here at the Veterans Memorial.
Okay, Mr. Reyes, papakiusapan lang po namin kayo kung pwede kayong malayo dun sa merong bullhorn na nagsasalita para mas malinaw po nating naririnig yung sinasabi nyo. There have been other cases filed under this administration. So how can you say that that President Aquino is not keeping his eye on the ball?
Hello, can you repeat that? Paulit lang po.
Okay, Renato, si Ron Cruz to ng ANC, no? Ang sinasabi mo is yung mahina, sa pagkakaintindi ko, ang sinasabi mo ay mahina yung kasong final against President Gloria Arroyo, kaya pinagbibintangan mo ang administrasyon, more specifically si President Aquino, para makapag-post ng bail si former President Gloria Macapagal-Arroyo. Tingin mo ba kulang ang ginagawa ng presidente at ang administrasyon na ito kahit na nag-file ng ibang mga kaso against former President Arroyo?
Well, ang tanong nga ho dyan eh, how many non-bailable cases have been filed against GMA so far? Sa ngayon po, last year there was only one non-bailable case that they filed in court, which was the election sabotage case, na medyo minadali dahil nga po hinahabol nila yung temporary restraining order na inisyo ng Supreme Court na mapapahintulot kay dating Pangulong Arroyo ng palabas ng bansa. Bukod doon po, wala nang naging ibang kasong non-bailable. Liban na lamang po din sa pinakahuli, ang PCSO plunder case na isinampa lamang po ilang araw, isang linggo bago ang State of the Nation address ng Pangulo. At ito po ay pending pa rin sa Sandigan Bayan. Ang tanong ho, wala na ho bang ibang maaaring isampa o bakit hindi na isasampa yung iba pa hong kasong may kinalaman si GMA tulad ng 2004 election fraud na malinaw na minakaw niyang election kay FPJ? Bakit hindi pa ho nasasampa yung any case related to human rights violations committed by the Arroyo administration during her time? Ang nagsasampa ho ngayon ang mga kaso yan, mga victims po ho yung people outside government. So we are not satisfied with the way the moves to hold GMA accountable are going. This is not enough. And clearly, the Arroyo camp will exploit all of the weaknesses, all of the shortcomings of the Aquino government, and they will be able to skirt justice because they have the means, they have the money, they have the lawyers, they have the friends in high places. So unless we really push for the filing of more cases, more non-bailable cases against GMA, then the former president will surely be able to evade justice.
Okay, Nato, gano'ng kadami ng mga kasamahan nyo dyan na nagpro-protesta ngayon?
I think we have more than 100 people na po yata ang nakatipon ngayon. Medyo biglaan lang po kasi ito na itinatawag namin after it was reported in the media that GMA might be released on bail today.
Madami pa bang padating?
Sa palagay ko po, may mga parating pa ko eh. Maghihintay lang po kami dito at gusto lang po namin ipapatid sa dating Pangulong Arroyo na talagang hindi kami titigil hanggat hindi siya napapanagot. Sana makita niya yung mga taong nagpo-protesto dito sa labas.
Okay, ang sinasabi mo kanina that you want President Aquino and his administration to file more cases against President Gloria, former President Gloria Macapagal Arroyo for her to stay detained in any place. Pag ang administrasyon ba ay nag-file pa ng mga susunod na kaso, kayo ba ay matutuwa na? Masasatisfy ba kayo?
Well, mabuti at matutuwa kami kung magpa-file din sila ng mga kaso kaugnay ng 2004 election fraud sa Hello Garci, kung magpa-file sila ng human rights cases against GMA. That would be very acceptable. That would be very positive. But right now, it's the victims eh. Yung mga ordinaryong tao, yung mga nabiktima, sila pa ho yung nagsasampan ng kaso ngayon eh. At mahina po yung natatanggap sa suporta maging sa Department of Justice. Hindi ho natin nakikita yung ganoon talagang porsigidong mga pagsisikap eh. So that is our dilemma right now. No? If we do not pursue these cases, then GMA will be able to evade justice one way or another.
Okay, Renato Reyes, the Secretary General of Bayan. Nato, maraming salamat. Alex Santos, our correspondent who's stationed also at the main gate of the Veterans Memorial Medical Center. Alex Santos, thank you very much for your update.
Renato Reyes, ng Bayang, ng Grupong Bayan. Also, Ron, dito, mag-aantabay muna kami at mga ilang pa mga gawad ng media para sa ganap ng paglaya nitong si temporary freedom nitong si dating Pangulong Gloria Macapagal Arroyo.
Alex Santos, thank you very much for that update. Alex Santos with the Secretary General of Bayan leading the protests there. Renato Reyes saying that there are almost 100 people there. Alex saying that those people are part of actually two groups, Bayan and Gabriela. If you're seeing on the screen, Alex explained that there may be just two or three policemen outside the gates of the VMMC, but there are more inside who may stop the protesters from going inside the gates of the VMMC. We were also able to talk to attorney Raul Lambino, lawyer for the Arroyos. He's saying that they're just waiting for the release order to arrive there at the VMMC to be presented to the PNP, and we'll wait for them to give the go-ahead for Mrs. Arroyo to leave the premises. Gretchen Malalad earlier reporting that the release order will be released by around 1 p.m. Again, the camp of former President Gloria Macapagal Arroyo has paid a 1 million peso bail after Judge Jesus Mupas allowed the posting of the bail in connection with the electoral sabotage case against Mrs. Arroyo. With this development, Mrs. Arroyo may already be allowed to leave the VMMC. Attorney Lambino saying, he was just guessing that most probably Mrs. Arroyo will go back to her residence at La Vista, Quezon City, once they receive that release order. Although we had DZMM's Henry Atuelan saying that they may still have to wait for the release order of the doctors at the VMMC. Mrs. Arroyo is under hospital arrest at the VMMC. We had COMELEC Chairman Sixto Brillante saying that they will file a motion for reconsideration on the ruling either today or tomorrow. Even though Judge Mupas has allowed the posting of bail for the Arroyo camp, Judge Mupas has denied bail for Arroyo's co-accused in this case, namely former Maguindanao Governor Andal Ampatuan Sr. and former Maguindanao Election Supervisor Lintang Bidol. Gretchen Maladad reporting a while ago that the Pasay RTC explained that they allowed posting of bail for Mrs. Arroyo, even though this is supposed to be a non-bailable offense, because the Pasay RTC thinks that the evidence against Mrs. Arroyo is weak and the testimony of the primary witness for the case, Nori Unas, is just hearsay. Nori Unas saying before that he heard Mrs. Arroyo say that he wants a 12-0 vote or win for her senatorial lineup during the elections. Also reported today that the Sandigan Bayan already issued a hold departure order. This is in connection with another case. This is the plunder case involving Mrs. Arroyo and the use of PCSO funds. Aside from that, the former president still has also another pending case, two counts of graft for the botched NBN-ZTE deal, also at the Sandigan Bayan. We will continue to give you updates as soon as they are available. Gretchen Malalad and Alex Santos, following the developments there, please stay tuned to ANC for those. For the meantime, we now go back to the JBC interviews.
We could not immediately hire permanent clerks or researchers. But the thing is, we must fill up the vacancies, because it's intolerable that the vacancies is at 25%.
What is your position in the adoption of rules to the effect that instead of an oral testimony of witnesses, the witnesses' testimony shall be in affidavit form, which we sometimes call judicial affidavits? Are you in favor of the use of judicial affidavits?
I am in favor of that use, provided that there's an ability to cross-examine the
Of course, the other party will have to cross-examine. But there are some resistance, or there are resistances rather, because if you do that, especially in criminal cases, judges will not be able to determine the demeanor of a witness. And one way of determining the demeanor of a witness is the credibility of the witness is the demeanor of the witness when he takes the witness stand.
I think that the determination of the demeanor of the witness might come during the cross-examination.
Well, but if you allow a judicial affidavit, you can just imagine that if the judicial affidavit is prepared by the counsel, of course it will be the best judicial affidavit. It will be the best affidavit because practically the witness is already taught what to say. Unlike when the testimony of the witness is made orally, and I'm referring to direct examination, where the case is developed through the questions and answers. And you can also, it's also needed, I mean, you can determine the demeanor of the witness, therefore, not only on cross-examination, but likewise on direct examination.
Yes, you are articulating the possible drawback of the proposal.
But that's why, it was a follow-up question, because according to you, the demeanor of the witness may be determined through the cross-examination. But what I'm saying also is that you can also determine the demeanor of the witness on direct examination.
Of course.
Yeah, so what is your position now? You are in favor of judicial affidavit?
Well, I thought that you were proposing it as a means to accelerate cases.
Yeah, no, I'm just asking if you're in favor of a judicial affidavit instead of a direct examination in order to expedite cases.
Well, I'm inclined to favor. To some extent, yeah.
What about amendment of the rules of court? Are you proposing the amendment of the rules of court in order to expedite cases? Because I think if I heard you right, you were saying that he will be strict on the periods within which to terminate a case. Did I get you right?
Yes.
Yeah. But we have already periods under the rules.
It's a matter of implementing it strictly.
You want that it be strictly implemented?
Yeah.
Now, aside from the strict implementation of the periods provided for by the rules and other laws, what else do you suggest?
It's probably good to remove technical requirements.
Technical, like what?
Like, for instance, if there are defects in the verification or in the
You're referring to initiatory pleadings, probably complaints.
If there's a defect in the verification or similar things, that judges should not be strict.
But if you know, just for your information, in the data submitted by presented by Dean Bautista yesterday, the disposal rating of the Supreme Court is high. I think it's something like 60%. The disposal rating of the Court of Appeals likewise is possible, no? But the disposal rating of the Sandigan Bayan, the lower courts, is low. Probably the reason is that the Court of Appeals and the Supreme Court are not trier of facts. In other words, they are not trial courts.
All right.
We resolve cases based on the pleadings, no? Also in the Court of Appeals, they resolve cases based on the pleadings. But in the lower courts, before they could decide cases, they will have to hear the cases.
Yes.
Also in the Sandigan Bayan, because in Sandigan Bayan it's a unique court. It is an appellate court because the cases that are decided by the lower courts, insofar as commission of crimes by public official, go to the Sandigan Bayan on appeal.
Mm-hmm.
But they have also original jurisdiction. They hear cases. And the backlog of cases, I think, is attributable to the long process of presentation of evidence, which means trial. Do you agree? Tony, do you agree on that? In your practice of law, do you agree that there is really delay in the cases before trial courts? Do you agree?
That's right.
So aside from judicial affidavits and aside from strict adherence to the periods within which to resolve cases, what proposal?
Well, continuous trial. So.
Continuous trial. We have also that in the rules under the speedy trial, continuous trial.
But not strictly implemented.
What about the pretrial rule? Is the pretrial rule an effective measure of expediting the termination of cases?
Yes, of course.
Of course?
Yes.
Yeah. As a practitioner,